the Smoky Mountains, Neyland Stadium. We could only be in one place, Knoxville, Tennessee. Tomorrow, that'll be bustling with spring football. But tonight, we're at Lindsey Nelson Stadium for some SEC baseball. Some primetime teams taking center stage as you're watching the SEC on ESPN. Well, it seems everybody is chasing Kentucky and Arkansas in the Southeastern Conference race for a regular season title. Kentucky at 12-1, moved up to number 8 in the rankings. Arkansas continues to be the consensus number one team in America. Tennessee sitting there at 7-5, and LSU looking for their first conference series win of the year. Yes, I said that from the defending national champs. Dave Neal alongside former SEC Player of the Year and Big Leaguer Chris Burke. Glad you could join us tonight. And Berkey, let's start with Tennessee, because once again, it seems as though Tony Vitale has put together the pieces. This team is gelling along, but there is one thing that jumps at me. That is the power coming off of these bats.
Offense, and more offense. When you talk about this Tennessee baseball team, it is the best power lineup in America. They lead the country in slugging percentage. They lead the Southeastern Conference in home runs in conference play. Last weekend, they hit 14 at Auburn, and it's not just one guy. It's not just two guys. It is up and down the order. They can go 12 or 13 deep. This is one scary lineup, Dave.
Well, speaking of scary, I think some folks in LSU are a little scary about what's happening with this LSU baseball team. There seems to be that hangover again for the third consecutive year from an SEC national champ. This team has yet to win an SEC series. There is some pop in this lineup, and these guys have got to carry this team. Bear and Tommy Tanks. I love those nicknames.
Yeah, how about that? A bear and a tank leading off the LSU's lineup. You don't see that every day, but they moved Jared Jones into the leadoff spot on Tuesday. Jay Johnson did, and all he did was hit three homers. Tommy White, the best home run hitter in college baseball over the last 3 years, 62 career home runs.
Well, here is the lineup for LSU tonight, and after that three home run performance, Jared Bear Jones will still lead things off, followed by Tommy White. The freshman Larson getting some work in there. As you go down the list, there's some young guys getting some work. Brady Neal, the sophomore behind the plate. Paxton Kling, another sophomore, hitting ninth. But on the mound, it is a different kind of night for Tennessee. Chris Stamos gets the ball, 3-0 on the year with a 3.46 ERA. What's going on with Stamos, and why is he in this role?
Well, they're going to use him kind of as an opener. A.J. Causey's been throwing number one. He's been struggling. So they give the ball to Stamos, who is a transfer from Cal, who started some in his time in the Pac-12, but has been very effective early on, and they're going to try to see if he can't get him off to a better start here on Friday night.
And Stamos will start off. Jared Jones with a strike. Stamos hasn't gone more than an inning and two-thirds in any game this season. Be anxious to see if he can get through this lineup at least once. But Jones, the sophomore, to start things off. Will check swing, and he did go. That'll be strike number two. Jones 6-4, 253 at the plate out of Marietta, Georgia. All freshman a year ago, a freshman All-American. But those three home runs against McNeese, how about four hits? We talk about three home runs. He threw a double in there just, I guess, to get some exercise.
Just cuz.
Here's the 0-2 from Stamos. That one is hit high in the air. Out to center field, and that is where Hunter Inslee will make the catch. And it, I tell you what, any ball that gets up in the air today here at Lindsey Nelson Stadium, it will be an eventful play.
Yes, the wind is blowing hard from right to left. So that ball right there on a certain night here at Lindsey Nelson might have a chance, but not with the wind blowing across the way it is. You're really going to have to hit a ball from the left center gap to left field line probably to get it out here tonight.
Well, here's a guy that can certainly do that, and Tommy White, the junior transfer from St. Pete Beach, Florida, stepping in there. Tommy at 324. 11 home runs on the year. Last five games, Tommy's been on a little bit of a heater with a couple of home runs, hitting over 350. See his overall numbers. Over 60 career home runs. And that pitch misses 89 miles an hour from Chris Stamos.
Yeah, I mean, this guy right here has had two of the best years in the history of college baseball to start a career. Set the national freshman home run record as a freshman 2 years ago, and then last year led the country in RBIs with 105.
That's down the line and right. It will drop in for a base hit. It'll bounce off the top of the wall. Tommy White rounds first on his way to second, and he'll be in there with a double, and that'll be number five on the year for Tommy White.
So Tommy Tanks can control the barrel as well as anybody. You see how deep that ball gets. But the ability to keep the barrel square, even on the backside of the hitting zone, allows him to flight that ball through the wind, a rocket one hopper off the wall. Can I tell you a crazy stat? That is the first base hit Chris Stamos has given up to a right-handed hitter all year. 32 hitters, the first base hit he's given up to a righty. Pretty wild.
When you told me that earlier today, I thought you were lying to me again. That's kind of what you do. But you weren't. You were actually telling me the truth.
Oh, goodness. Every once in a while, I'll mix a truthful statement in there.
Here is Ashton Larson, the 6'2 freshman out of Overland Park, Kansas. Hitting in the three hole, just his ninth start of the year.
This is just kind of tells you where LSU's at right now. They're searching for some things. They really, what they're searching for is a left-handed bat to mix up the righties. And, you know, it's an offense with Jones and White and Bingham and Travinsky that can feel very right-handed heavy. And so they're going to give Larson a shot here to mix it up right there in the middle of the power right-handed bats.
Fouled off. Yeah, after talking to Jay Johnson earlier today, I got the feeling that if you're a good, really good left-handed hitter, there's a chance that they probably know about you.
Yeah. Get in contact with the Tigers. They're interested.
This LSU team comes in ninth in the conference, hitting .284 overall. That one is lined, and this could be two, and it will be, and the inning is over. Boy, Larson hit it right on the barrel. The problem was it went right to Christian Moore. Back in Knoxville, Tony Vitallo, now in his seventh season as the skipper of the Tennessee Volunteers, a club that is now 27-6, 7-5 in league play. Of course, lose their opening series, but they have rattled off three straight series wins. Ole Miss, Georgia, Auburn falling to the Vols. This is the lineup, Christian Moore. There's Blake Burke. He has been tearing it up, 4-10. Tears also at 4-10. I mean, this lineup is just dangerous top to bottom. The guy getting the ball today, Gage Jump, a little change in the rotation and how they're lining things up. Holman, who's been dynamite all year, will pitch tomorrow, but Jump gets it tonight.
Yeah, Jump, the transfer from UCLA, has number one stuff. You will see him, and the stuff jumps. It's a fastball up to 95 miles an hour. He needs all three pitches tonight. When he's at his best, you'll see the fastball, slider, changeup combo. And it's premium stuff. The question is, can he get them deeper into the ball game? Because they've certainly had bullpen problems. They need a solid outing from Jump here in this one to give him a chance.
Yeah, Jay Johnson said a perfect scenario for us tonight is to get six innings out of him with a lead, and we can go to Griffin Herring in the bullpen and try to close out this, get game one. And we like our chances to win a series. So we'll see if that kind of plays out and how that will play out. But Christian Moore, the second baseman, will lead things off. Christian, the junior, hitting .351, and he looks at a ball inside. Tennessee leads this conference in overall batting average at .338. That is the third best batting average in the country. Big cut and a foul straight back. I mean, the extra base hit numbers are incredible. Look at the doubles. They lead the country in that department, and they're only second. Yeah. Only because Georgia hit three home runs last night. Otherwise, they'd be tied with the Dogs.
Yeah, I mean, it's simply the best lineup in the country. That's all there is to it. They have double-digit players with over 1,000 OPS. And similar to what LSU does with Jones and White, they're going to send their best two right at you. With Moore and Burke here in the one and two spots.
Moore fouls it straight back. He has been on a nice little run. He's homered in three of the last four games. How about a double in each of the last four games? Eight of his last 10 hits have been for extra bases.
Yeah, he kind of liked hitting on the plains last week.
Yes, I think they all did.
Yes.
This team put together a 14 home run series. No swing. 14 home runs in the series against Auburn. That is the most in program history in an SEC series. People can talk about this ballpark.
Yeah.
But they did it at that ballpark.
Did it on the road.
There's a chopper out to short. Braswell Fields throws, and it's offline, and Jones has to go chase it down.
So that should go as a base hit, but a play that Michael Braswell could have made. So all your momentum's going to your left. You have to throw it on the run because Christian Moore can really move, and that's one of those you almost have to feel like you're throwing it behind you, Dave, because your momentum's pulling you so much towards right field that the throw almost certainly will go that way, and a very tough chance it'll go as a base knock, but certainly one Braswell could have finished off.
Here is Blake Burke, first pitch he sees, slicing, foul, just foul. Oh my goodness, that ball was smoked off the wall, but fouled by a couple of feet.
And that is the biggest difference this year with Blake Burke. He is hammering the ball to the backside of the field. That ball missed. It missed being a homer by about 3 feet of height and fair by about 3 feet of slice, but it's been a laser show with Blake Burke really from the jump this year. Leads the Southeastern Conference in hitting in SEC games. And he leads it by almost 30 points, Dave. Like, he has been the best hitter in SEC play from a batting average standpoint. Condon overall, but Burke has been the most consistent from a base hit standpoint.
He owns the nation's longest active hit streak at 23 games. He'll look at a strike on the inside part of the plate. 0-2 the count. 4-10 average overall. 11 homers, 30 runs batted in. And how about the 19 doubles coming off his bat? Just misses another double down the line.
Yeah, he's on a record-setting pace. Owns the Tennessee all-time record for homers. Of course, his man hitting the spot in front of him is only one behind. One of the two is going to finish their career with the all-time record. But he's hunting down the single-season record in doubles as well.
Up and in. 1-2 the count now.
So that's a setup pitch there, Dave. This is almost certainly a slider coming afterwards. Fastball right underneath the chin. I doubled it up. And that's respect. I think that's a sign of respect for just how mature Blake Burke's approach has become this year, right? Last year, you'd have thrown a fastball up and bounced a breaking ball. He'd have swung and missed and walked back to the dugout. This year, Nate Yeske decided to double up with fastball up and in back-to-back pitches. Let's see if he goes to breaking ball here.
They're going to short. Can they turn it? Nope. Burke getting down the line. They'll get the out at second. So Braswell to Pearson. Little fielder's choice, not one.
I think Blake Burke was thinking what I was thinking. He, you know, a little tardy on those fastballs. His jump triples up there. Nice job of throwing that fastball up in the count consecutively.
Billy Squire to get you going.
For Billy Barrels.
Yeah. Billy Barrels. Billy Amick back in the lineup tonight. Been out for a while. First pitch he sees upon his return is lifted high and deep. It's out of here. Welcome back, Billy Amick.
I'd say he's healthy.
The appendix removal didn't seem to bother him on his swing any.
I'd say he's healthy. Been begging to get back out there. Missed the previous two weekends against Georgia and Auburn and watched his buddies hit a whole bunch of home runs in his absence. And he decided to hop back in there and join the party as he gets a hanging breaking ball and launches it.
His first game back since May 24th against Ole Miss. Played on that Sunday, just said he just didn't feel right, and they came back here, and he was working out, and all of a sudden he had some pain, and they were like, man, you got to go check that out, and it turns out he needed to have surgery. First pitch he sees. first pitch he sees, he hits into the second section of the party deck out there. Went 396 feet as Kavaris Tier steps in.
Well, I guess Tony Vitello felt pretty good about plugging him right back in the lineup because he put him in the three hole. And, yeah, that's what you do.
Home run number 11 for Amick. Tears has 10 of them. Takes a big hack, fouls it straight back. It's full at 3-2.
I mentioned Blake Burke leads the Southeastern Conference in league games and batting. Kavaris Tears is second. First time getting a chance to play every day. Boy, has he made the most of it.
No swing, and that'll be a walk.
Well, Billy Barrels, the first pitch back after some time away, gets a hanging breaking ball and front zones this one. Look at him catch that thing just out in front, and it's a path that is in the zone forever. And even though he's a click early, the barrel stays square, the ball is launched, and left field's a good place to elevate the ball here this evening.
20 pitches so far here in the first inning. For Gage, Jump. By the way, that was just the fourth home run allowed by Jump this year. He did go. Boy, this team, you just start looking. The top five guys in this lineup all have double-digit home runs.
You know what's even more remarkable, Dave, is they come at you with Burke, Tears, and Dryland, right? Three of their first five hitters are left-handed. And so you think, man, Jump's a great matchup. Tears is hitting 459 versus lefties. Dryland's hitting 389 versus lefties, and Burke's hitting 333. So you don't have to mess with it.
But it's not the norm, though. So my question is, like, what is it about these Tennessee hitters? I mean, what is it about left-handed pitchers and their ability to hit left-handers? Because that's just not the norm, those numbers you're throwing.
It isn't. I think it shows, we talked about it with Burke, as we see the power that this team has. It's five dudes with double digits, and Curley's knocking on the door. It's the ability to hit the backside of the field. And, right, we saw Dryling almost do it right there. Of course, Burke hit a ball right off the top of the wall, a couple feet foul. Like, you see Dryling take that breaking ball right there. This is just a group of left-handed hitters that has bought in to letting the ball travel when they're facing a lefty, and because of that, they become very difficult to handle.
Well, that one just misses. Boy, the old double clutch by Brady Neal behind the plate. Like, Neal, are you sure?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was not where that breaking ball was designed to finish. But the high breaking ball probably did catch a piece of the zone. C.J. Burdett disagreed.
Dryling, 353 hitter on the year. Swing and a miss. There is the second out of the inning. 39th strike out of the year for Jump.
Well, again, it's Dryling had shown the ability to let the breaking ball travel and lay off of it. So you got to lean into that heater, and that was a good one right there, right past Dryling. Jump tries to recover from the two-run homer to Amick.
And now Dean Curley. Step in. Dean, the shortstop. Boy, having a nice young freshman season. 341, nine homers. Played mostly at shorts, had a couple games over at third base. Some injuries have gotten him on the field as a youngster. And don't know that they envisioned him having this many reps at the plate, but it's worked out nicely for him. He's showing he can certainly swing it against SEC pitching.
Yeah, he's doing just fine, I'd say. you just never know, right? When your shot comes available and take advantage of it, that who's going to take him out of the lineup now as he's continued week after week to prove he belongs.
That ball's belted high and deep to left center. Paxton Kling to the wall, and he'll make the catch a few feet shy of hitting the wall. But an explosion off the bat of Billy Amick gives Tennessee a 2-0 lead.
In the country.
Tommy Tanks walks it off, and the LSU Tigers will face the Gators in the finals.
Top of the 11th, game one.
Beloso, big-time home run. The Tigers win game one.
The LSU offense has just been hitting on all cylinders. There it is. The Tigers are champions.
Number seven for LSU last year in Omaha. What a team that was. What a ride for Jay Johnson and company. But again, man, it just seems it's an unfortunate trend for these teams in the SEC to win a national championship and then just struggle right out of the gate the next season. And that is certainly what has happened to LSU. 22-12, 3-9 in the league. Mac Bingham, the senior, first one in. He hits it way up in the air. Kavaris Tears backpedals, but he'll give way to the center fielder, Hunter Ensley. And that'll be out number one.
Yeah, you know, I think it really boils down to the fact that to win the whole thing, you're old, right? I mean, if you win the whole thing, you're playing juniors and seniors. And so you're going to lose a big part of those teams. And then the other thing is this league is so deep and so tough that the margins between winning and losing, even for teams that ended up winning the whole thing, are so slim that when you lose those impact players, those veteran players, man, you could take it on the chin immediately. So I think when you look at it through that lens, it's not as shocking as it feels, even though it is pretty crazy that, it's with their start, it could potentially happen 3 years in a row.
Swing and a miss from Josh Pearson, the LSU second baseman, the junior out of West Monroe, Louisiana. Outfielder slash infielder, of course, last year was part of that big postseason run. Started all 13 games out in left field for the Tigers. Played really well as he pops this one up. Cal Stark behind the plate, and that one will be a souvenir a few rows back.
Yeah, it's interesting. A couple years in a row now, Jay Johnson's taken an outfielder and made him an infielder. Of course, Gavin Dugas did it. Tommy White, heck, DH'd, ended up coming over playing third base and not afraid to make a position change to get an extra bat in the lineup. And Josh Pearson has spent almost all his time at LSU in the outfield, but this year getting a chance to prove that he can play on the dirt.
One and two, the count. Fouled straight back. It is a cool, blustery evening here in Knoxville. Temperature's going to be down in the low 50s. The wind is subsiding somewhat. From when we got here, boy, it was howling.
Get some of that wind that was going on at the Masters.
Imagine playing golf in 40 mile an hour gusts on that place.
With greens running at a 12. No, I'll just watch it.
That one's lifted high in the air out to left. Dylan Dreiling, few steps back, few steps over, and makes the catch, two down. Sunday Night Baseball features the series finale between the Padres and the Dodgers. It's coming your way at 7 o'clock Eastern, 4 Pacific on ESPN, ESPN Deportes, and ESPN Radio. Coverage begins at 6 Eastern with Baseball Tonight, Sunday Night Countdown.
You could put together like a full all-star team with those two rosters, couldn't you?
I'd love to know what the math is on the payrolls for those two clubs.
Goodness.
Here is Hayden Travinsky. Hayden having a solid offensive season, hitting just a tick under 300, 8 homers and 31 runs batted in. In that catching rotation with Brady Neal and Alex Milazzo.
Got to be on the all-mustache team. I mean, it's just, it is a world-class lip swinger, as they would call it.
And you need it tonight.
I mean, yeah, that's right. Provides a little extra warmth.
Hayden fills up the batter's box. 6'3", 230 pounds. Check swing, did he go? Yes, he did. The inning is over on a high fastball at 90 miles an hour. Six in a row. First strike out of the game for Chris Stamos. Tony Vitello now in his seventh season of coaching this Tennessee program, and he has certainly put him on top of the baseball map. Nobody has won more games in college baseball since 2021, and how about that 2022 season? 57 wins, of course, fell a little bit shy of their goal, but last year they go back to Omaha. It has been remarkable what he has done. I mean, they certainly, anybody that follows college baseball, you start asking about some of the marquee teams, and Tennessee would certainly jump out on just about everybody's list.
Yeah, I mean, it's you know, it's since 2021, they have the most wins. They're the only SEC team that's been Omaha 2 out of 3 years.
The shift on Bargo and a line out to Braswell.
So, I mean, those are, you know, it's not a decade. It's not insanely long, sustained success. But when you're talking about 21, 22, 23, and now into the middle of 24, you have more wins than anybody else. And you go to Omaha 2 out of 3 years. Like, you at that point have established yourself with the elite programs in the Southeastern Conference.
And if you go back a few years, back to 2017, and start looking at numbers, Arkansas, a team that Tony Vitello was assistant coach for with Dave Van Horn, they had the most wins if you go back that far in the country. And the Hogs right now and playing at another level as a consensus number one team again this week.
And what's interesting is both of those programs, even, you know, SEC's had all these national championships.
Those two haven't won one.
They feel like they're going to be one of the next two. It is pretty remarkable how many different teams have won the national championship out of this conference.
By the way, Arkansas up 5-0 on Alabama. Hunter Inslee out in center field tonight for the Volunteers. 286, four homers, 17 runs batted in. Fouls that one off. We'll do it again at 2-2. I mean, of all the guys in the lineup that get all these headlines and people talk about them, whether they're Dean Curley, the freshman who's busted on the scene, or your Blake Burke or Christian Moore or Billy Ann, one guy just seems to keep plugging in the lineup is Hunter Inslee. Not a lot of flair, just gets it done.
No, and you know, he hasn't been out there every single day like he was to finish last season because of Villeneuve and Reese Chapman, some of the other pieces they can plug in. But especially against left-handers, they like to run him out there. He's been hitting the ball at the ballpark with more frequency here lately, and he plays such a solid center field.
Over his last 9 games, hitting .375 with a couple of homers. Making Gage Jump throw some pitches here. Gage Jump already up to 40 pitches with one out here in the second. Lifted out to center. Paxton Kling again on the run to the track and just shy of the wall. That's two out to center field that Kling has had to chase down.
Yeah, wrong night to hit it. Now, as you said, the wind has started to subside, but it's still cool and the ball not jumping like we've seen it here at times. But center, right center, it's a tall task, especially Oppo.
Since the two-run shot to Billy Amick, Gage Jump has retired four of the last five that he's faced. Cal Stark hitting ninth, the Tennessee catcher. Stark has 11 hits on the year, and four of them have left the yard. Six of those 11 have been extra base hits.
Coming off a monster weekend, had a monster game at Auburn where he hit a grand slam. Hit two homers and seven ribbies last weekend, part of the hit parade down there at Auburn.
Has three multi-hit games over his last four that he's played, but he'll go down swinging here to end the inning. Gage Jump with a nice 1-2-3 frame for LSU. We'll head to the third. We are heading to the third inning. Chris Stamos still on the mound for Tennessee. The young man with a 3-0 record and a 3.46 ERA has retired six straight. I need to correct myself. Something I said earlier, I said its longest outing was an inning and two-thirds. It's actually three innings against Albany back at the end of February. We'll try to match that right here, starting with Brady Neal. 7, 8, 9 due up. It'll be Neal, Braswell, and Paxton Kling for LSU. These two teams certainly have been among the best, as we were talking about, in college baseball. This is the 11th time they faced each other in the last 3 years, and five of those games have been in the postseason. Swing and a miss. Brady Neal goes down.
That's another K for Kiesel.
Back-to-back strikeouts now for Stamos.
Seems like he's got a pretty good feel of the breaking ball here early. That's a real slider to the outside edge. We know the fastball has some life to it, has a little carry to it, especially up in the zone. And if he can mix in that breaking ball, especially away to left-handers, that's a lethal combo.
Michael Braswell, a transfer from South Carolina, hitting .287 on the year with one homer and 18 runs batted in. Does have a couple of triples. Lifts that one high in the air. Boy, Dylan Dreiling completely lost it in a diving catch or attempt by Hunter Ensley. He can't make a play, and Braswell will wind up at second base. Boy, Dreiling had no clue whatsoever where that ball was.
It's that time of night. Here at dusk, kind of twilight. See, Dreiling's got his hands up immediately, and Ensley had a beat on it, just couldn't get there. Just that's one of those you'd like to see Curley, if he knew early enough, get out there. And well, that's a break for LSU. They just had nothing going offensively since Tommy White's double. And now a pop-up into shallow left field turns into a one-out double.
Braswell will take it. His seventh double of the year. And now Paxton Kling steps in. Well, this is a guy they really need to get going offensively. Just .221 on the year for the sophomore. Well, he came onto the scene last year as one of the premier players to come out of high school, out of Roaring Springs, Pennsylvania, hitting just .105 against SEC pitching this year. I mean, he was a top 10 recruit.
Mm-hmm. It showed flashes last year, right? But, you know, things can just be different sometimes when you're out there having to do it every single day. There's been some signs of life here recently where Jay Johnson feels like maybe it's starting to come. You know, from Pennsylvania, right? High school baseball. Now, he was on the circuit. He played big-time travel ball. But, like, you know, the day-in, day-out of getting it done in this league doesn't always happen immediately. Like, for the guy he's replacing, Dylan Cruz, that's not normal. And so for Kling, it's been a a rough sophomore season.
Oh. 2-2.
These are the kinds of things that will get you jump-started as a hitter. You take a questionable pitch and it goes your way. That pitch looked awfully good, Dave. Goes Kling's way. Let's see if he takes advantage of it.
That one scoots past Cal Stark. That'll get Braswell over to third base. So with only one out, Braswell 90 feet away from scoring LSU's first run.
Stamos is sitting there thinking, it was a pop-up to left, and I feel like I just struck the dude out, yet he could easily be back in the dugout right now. Instead, he's grinding his way here, trying to keep a shutout on the board.
Answers back with a strikeout, and Stamos fired up about it. Now at number two.
It's a big-time pitch. All right, we talked about that glove side slider being sharp tonight. Look at the angle on that thing. That is just coming for your knuckles. Right to the back knee of Paxton Kling, and a big second out right there. Stamos pitching around some adversity here in the third.
Top of the lineup now. Jared Jones flew out his first time up. We'll talk to Jay Johnson next half inning. Get a feel for where this team is. Tough to start your year with a bunch of top 10 teams and then come here on the road to try to break out of a bit of a funk that you're in.
Now, the schedule has not been kind. We talk about the hangover effect from winning the national championship. It also doesn't start when you're playing, help when you're playing a bunch of top 10 teams right out of the gate.
That one's just off the plate. Cal Stark like where the pitch location was as he gives a fist pump out there to Stamos, but nonetheless, 2-1.
What Tony V tell us today? Cal Stark keeps it positive always.
There is a strike, 2-2.
So the pitch before a fastball just off the edge doesn't go his way. And now a backdoor slider to get to two strikes. And Stamos just looks comfortable with all three of his pitches right now. The changeup has been effective as well.
Pitch 37, or 38 coming up on a 2-2 count to Bear Jones. A little bit low, it'll run full.
That was the changeup there. It's not quite competitive enough to draw the swing from Jones. See if he goes back to that slider that he got Kling with.
Way out in front, fouled, out of play.
It was that same slider. Not quite as sharp with the late break. Jones able to hook it foul. And you know, this is one of those deals where you got Tommy Tanks on deck, right? So it's you really don't want to walk Jones right here. By the same token, he's pretty dangerous in and of himself. You can't just challenge him over the heart of the plate either.
And he did walk him. Boy, the luxury of having Jared Jones in that leadoff spot. You get him up, the lineup flips, he's got a runner at third base, and Tommy White hitting behind him now. So now you got a chance to take the lead with one swing.
No doubt. I mean, that's why he's there, right? I mean, I think put your best hitters right out of the gate. Get them the most at-bats you possibly can. And this is exactly why you do something like that.
Tony Vitallo out to the mound. Looking down that bullpen. Is it causing down there getting loose? So, and he's going to go that direction and try to get that righty-righty matchup. Definitely change the angle. But I think that they got as much as they wanted out of Chris Stamos tonight. And Chris is probably feeling like he should be in the dugout.
Yeah, I mean, if it's not for the twilight, the ball being lost in left field, I mean, who knows? He might have pitched himself even deeper. I think big picture-wise, you got to be pretty excited if you're Tennessee, because he certainly pitched well enough to earn himself crack at it again next week.
I thought I saw him point down the right field line to.
Yeah, he did it right when he walked out. Now they're a little late to. Jeff Head didn't see him when he walked out.
So there will be a change, and we will get A.J. Causey on the mound when we come back. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Good look at the Tennessee River. And a good look at A.J. Causey, who had been the opening game starter for Tennessee until tonight, but they're bringing him out of the bullpen, the junior out of Harvest, Alabama. 6'3", 205. You see the numbers on him. The last two outings have been really a surprise the way his season got started. He just is, especially his last outing, was just one of those that make you scratch your head a little bit. And hopefully maybe a change of pace might change his course.
Yeah, he was absolutely dominant for his first five outings. He gave up three runs in his first four outings. He gave up five in his first five outings total. And, Dave, the last two weekends he's given up 16 in four innings. So Stamos was very good, and they're going to give the ball to Causey, who was fantastic to start the year but has really fallen on hard times. Now, it is a much more effective look to right-handers, kind of a low three-quarter slide, sinker, slider, changeup, and for a kid who's had a rough go of it the last 2 weeks, you can't think of a much more difficult opportunity to get back on the horse than facing one of the best hitters in the sport with two on and two out. Here you go.
Well, we'll find out if he's got his stuff back or not here pretty quickly. Tommy White steps in. Tommy doubled. His first time up, smashed one down the right side. One hopped off the wall. Big swing and a miss there. Count even at 1-1.
That's what he wants to do to right-handers. He wants to throw that kind of frisbee slider that really works horizontally across the zone.
Causey started the year in the bullpen. And A.J. Russell had some arm issues. Shut him down, although we think he's getting closer to being back in the mix. But this one is shot back up the middle, and LSU will scratch one across as Braswell touches home. And Tommy White just picks up his 30th run batted in of the year.
That's just Tommy Tanks being Tommy Tanks right there. A sinker on the inner third of the plate after three straight frisbee sliders. Here's a sinker kind of middle in, and Tanks rifles it right back up the gut. And the Tigers are on the board. And again, credit the at-bat from Jared Jones to give Tommy White the opportunity.
Jones stands at second after walking. Tommy White over at first. Two-hit night for Tommy. And here is the freshman Ashton Larson, who, I mean, hit a laser, but right to Christian Moore at second base, his first time up. And he'll look at a strike there. It's 1-1. Larson again making just his ninth start. Larson drafted by the Twins last summer in the draft, the July draft. Turned that down to come to LSU. Ranked as the 13th best outfielder in the country by Perfect Game, a top 100 overall player. And he swings and misses that one. It's 2-2.
There's a good changeup right there. That's what he's got to have to get left-handers out. He's got to be able to get ahead and then get to that changeup. Something tells me he's going to go right back to it here. That was a heater. 93 at the bottom. Interesting.
Now the count is full at 3-2. Two outs, runners will be going. Defense will play them straight up. And he misses inside, and they are now loaded. For Mac Bingham.
Now batting the left fielder, number 9, Max Bingham.
a senior transfer out of San Diego, California, by way of Arizona, where he played 4 years, including a season with Jay Johnson. So Max stepping to the plate. 1-for-4 this year with a bases loaded. That one hit was a double. Also has a walk. First team all Pac-12 performer last year, where he hit 360 with 10 homers. Already up to 8 long balls here in 2024.
This just feels like a huge at-bat for A.J. Causey's confidence, doesn't it? I mean, can he figure out a way to get out of trouble?
Big swing and a miss. On the flip side, talking to Jay Johnson today, this feels like a really big at-bat for LSU as a team.
Yes. And, you know, they're in a spot where they need every ball game they got a chance to win. And early in the game, but a big spot.
That's just off the plate, 1-2.
It's one heck of a take right there by Mac Bingham. That ball did not miss by much. And you see, it's kind of an early take. Cal Stark makes it look good, but that one's definitely down and away.
Swing and a miss. Bingham goes down swinging. The Tigers will leave him loaded. Causey gets out of it. 2-1, Tennessee. Tennessee River, Dave Neal, Chris Burke joining us down in that LSU dugout is their skipper, Jay Johnson. And, Jay, we were talking about, you know, certainly there are moments in a game and it's early, but that was one of those moments you feel like you need to win a couple of those throughout the game. I know there's a long way to go, but talk to me about where the mindset is of your club.
Yeah, we're excited to be here. It's one of the best teams in the country right now, and we're going through a stretch where that's all that we're playing, and we just need to get a little bit better. You know, we've lost some tough ones that we've been close in, and, you know, at-bats like that are the ones where you get over the hump. So hopefully we'll get a couple more of those and turn out on the right side.
You flip things up with Jump going number one this weekend. How have you felt about his outing so far?
Yeah, it's good. I mean, they do a great job with two strikes, so the one thing is they push the pitch count up really quickly on him in the first inning. We were able to get some of that back last inning, but need to get through some of these dangerous hitters a little quicker.
Yeah, long way to go. Skip, thanks for joining us.
All
we'll
right,
talk
guys.
To you later, buddy.
All right,
thanks.
Thank you.
Boy, they have had you want to talk about a heck of a run, and they open things up against Mississippi State, who I think a lot of folks, because of the way it went last year, you know, certainly were – but that's a club that certainly
– make it host.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, they're right in the mix of it.
I mean, then Florida, Arkansas, Vanderbilt, now Tennessee. Goodness gracious.
Now it does soften a little bit if there's such a thing in this league. It does. They still have to play A&M from the West, but they have their chances down the stretch. They got to keep figuring out ways to make sure, you know, it's kind of that old adage, don't get swept on the road.
Yeah.
Right? And you got to figure out a series or two maybe down the stretch where you can sweep one yourselves.
Well, it sounded like it was off the end of the bat by Christian Moore, but he'll take the base hit to the right side. Just kind of had a weird sound to it.
Yeah, maybe a little towards the end, but man, this dude's such a good hitter. I mean, you know, he comes in his freshman year, and him and Blake Burke both light the world on fire by, you know, just kind of hiding down the bottom of the lineup. Well, he hadn't been hiding the last couple of years. He is – it's an All-American hitter who just puts a professional swing on a ball to the backside of the field, and he has really turned into a star.
From an average standpoint, he came into this, he was like the fourth best average on this team. But 13 homers and 32 runs batted. And I mean, it's just, and 12 doubles.
Yeah.
It's just, I mean.
And you got to deal with him first.
Yeah.
Right? And then you get this guy.
Just
as right. big a problem.
Blake Burke. Hit into a fielder's choice his first time up. Fouls that one off. Of course, Burke with that 23-game hit streak.
Jason Condridge Holloway, one of the all-time great Tennessee, not just baseball players, but athletes. Of course, a legend in the Southeastern Conference. Number retired out there on the wall, just 4 games back of the all-time record.
There's Mr. Holloway.
What a dude. There's a great SEC story on Condridge Holloway. If you hadn't seen it, watch it.
He was such a – Kenny Chesney's the one who produced and kind of hosted the thing, and that's kind of impact Condridge had on, like, Kenny Chesney, who grew up a Tennessee fan. They talk about Vols for life, and there's certainly one in Condridge Holloway. The epitome of the VFL. Blake Burke. We'll look at a 3-2 count.
Watch Blake. Blake's going to make the call himself here. Watch Blake go safe. No. Third base umpire Michael Snover disagreed, and now you got a full count.
Back up the middle, off the bag, and over the glove of Josh Pearson. I'm not sure Josh would have had much of a chance to make a play on that, but nonetheless, he didn't even have the chance.
No, I agree. I think it was going to be a base hit either way. I thought when it happened that Christian Moore was going to be able to take third because of it, but the ball actually stayed online and went to Paxton Kling. Is Nate Yeske coming out to have a conversation because of this guy right here? Billy Barrels is back, and he gets a first pitch breaking ball and goes launch piece to the seats in left field. That's how you announce your return with authority. And now Nate Yeske wants to make sure they have a meeting about the game plan, because the first pitch breaking ball didn't seem to work.
I think they're going to change that up. Namek, 11th home run of the season.
This is always those interesting conversations, though. You hit a first pitch homer on a breaking ball. Do you think the guy's looking for it again, or do you think he's not going to throw me that again?
You're the hitter. What would you say?
Well, I would think he's not going to throw it again, right? And I've played for pitching coaches that made a point to throw whatever pitch the hitter hit out last time, first pitch again, just because of that line of thinking. The problem is you look really dumb if the guy launches it again. Let's see what they do.
Namek, the transfer from Clemson, a couple of years with the Tigers. They start him off first pitch, 90 miles an hour in there for a strike.
No breaking ball this time.
Big cut, fouls that one back.
Namek makes that move that a lot of hitters are going to these days. I feel like Paul Goldschmidt was kind of the first one that I noticed that popularized this, but you'll see he'll almost lean backwards away from the strike zone. The bat's kind of low. He's leaning away from the strike zone, and then he'll engage his posture over the strike zone as he gets ready, right? Christian Moore kind of does it. It's kind of like I'm going to do the opposite of what I want to end up doing, right? And so some guys start maybe with an open stance and then they stride back close. This modern trend here of like leaning back with your upper body and then coming down and over the zone as you load, it really gives a hitter great plate coverage.
Yeah.
We see that Drew Burris from Georgia Tech has the most exaggerated version of that move that I've ever seen. I mean, he is like, it's like it almost looks uncomfortable the way he gets set up to start. But it's a move you see a lot of young hitters trying to emulate, and it makes a lot of sense. See him kind of backing off the plate, and then he's going to get over it as he loads.
And a called strike three. 92-mile, maybe his best fastball of the night.
Wow, this is the same pitch he threw to start the AB, down and in. Looked like it was over the plate. I think Billy probably thought it was down, and he think he has an argument. But very similar to the first pitch of the AB, and just a heck of a spot right there by Gage Jump to get a big first out.
Goes back. It's easy for me to say this sitting up here behind home plate, but it's one of those that's too close at two strikes to leave it in the hands of the guy behind the plate.
Well, I think the hard part is if you're Amick, you're probably looking, you know, there's breaking ball, there's changeup, there's fastball away, and most hitters tend to think, man, if the guy paints one on the inner black, then that's the hardest pitch for me to get to, especially when it's down and in.
Now it's Kavaris Tears, and again, this lineup, there are just not any weak spots in it. This guy rolls to the plate hitting 410 with 10 homers. That has settled into the right field spot. He's worked really hard on that, spent the summer working on that part of his game. They knew he could hit.
Brady Neal getting beat up back there right now. But, yeah, Tears has made a really big jump physically this year. And because of that, he's earned the right to be out there every day. There was certainly flashes of it last year where people knew he had a chance to be a star. And, boys, he put it all together this year.
Two on. And that one misses upstairs. It is now 3-1.
Well, he needs to go back to that same fastball he threw Amick, that glove side fastball down and on the edge. Because if he doesn't right here with the wind kind of dying down, Mr. Tears could certainly leave the yard here.
Take another look.
So it looks on the high end of things, but probably right there at the top. I mean, it's a 50-50 ball.
Fourth full count of the night for Gage Jump. Way out of play. Now the other thing about that last pitch, though, is Brady Neal never moved his mitt. It hit him square.
Yes.
Brady Neal, you see him behind the plate, the sophomore. He has, you know, fought through a back injury last year. Really cost him a bunch of time after really mid-April on. Didn't play the rest of the year. And that one misses inside, and they'll be loaded.
It's just, man, the top five hitters in this lineup. I mean, again, it's a lineup that has tremendous depth. But, you know, I think there's a legitimate chance they're going to have all five of these guys are going to go in the top three rounds. Now, I'm sure we have seen that before. I don't remember it. And, you know, you just see the quality of at-bats that all of these guys are putting together. And Dreiling, who has done a bunch of damage with the bases loaded, gets a shot right here.
And this Tennessee team is made for grand slams. They have 9 grand slams this year.
Yeah, they set the program record last week.
They have 24 hits with the bases loaded this year. 19 of those have been for extra bases. Those 9 grand slams, by the way, they are chasing down Arizona State from 2003, who has the NCAA record of 14. One and one to Dreiling. That one's up in the zone.
And they've spread it around, too. It's, you know, there's some guys with multiple grand slams, but there's been a bunch of dudes that have come up with that big hit with the bases drunk.
Boy, 3-1 right now for Dreiling, who he's hitting .429 with the bases loaded, 3-for-7 with a grand slam. And he walked him in. And now some LSU players running out of that dugout toward the bullpen, as this seems like it is perhaps a defining moment of this game.
Well, we just had one last half inning for LSU on offense, and Tennessee was able to minimize the damage and get off the field with just one run. And then right on the heels of that, you got to face this incredibly talented top of the order, and Tennessee is counterpunched here. And boy, Jump's got his hands full here to get out of here to keep the damage at a minimum.
Curley, he's got a grand slam. Eight different players have a grand slam. This one will stay in the park toward the line and right, and the catch is made. Here's the tag from third and the throw. Oh, got him, double play. Brady Neal puts the tag. And that'll end the inning, perhaps.
Challenging the ruling of the play of out. The previous play is under review.
Well, I tell you, live, it looked like they got him. What a throw by the freshman. I mean, you know, the on the run, stop your momentum, deliver a strike, and Neal doing a heck of a job. Ooh, I don't know now. Was the tag up there by the shoulder, Dave?
Looks like the forearm.
All of a sudden, that looks a lot closer than it looked live. I agreed with C.J. Burdette. And I tell you, if the glove doesn't arrive until it's above the elbow, then I think the hand was there. What do you think?
Well, I just think that this isn't going to end up like it did for us the other night in Starkville where we sat there for 40 minutes.
The ball beats him. Obviously, Neal's got to go from one side of the plate to the other.
Jeff Head was on that crew with us in Starkville last week.
We need to go reminisce with him about that.
Yeah, let's not. Let's pretend that didn't happen. Let's move on. Heck of a throw, though, by Larson out and right.
Incredible.
Burke trying to tag up and score, and it's just hard to see, like, where his hand is on that plate when the tag is made on that angle. It just –
yeah, here – this will be the look here. This is the look.
But it's still hard to see the plate, though, Burke. It's hard
That's
to
– But you can see where does the glove hit him.
Like, right above the elbow, between the shoulder and the elbow?
Based on the year, I don't think that'll be overturned. I don't think that's indisputable.
There it is. They call it the plate about stands. Tennessee's been charged one they have one left.
You were on it, Berkey. Nice play for LSU to get off the field. Only give up the one run. It's 3-1, Tennessee. A lot going on here in Knoxville. Gorgeous look at this campus in downtown Knoxville. Really put a lot of time, energy, and money into revitalizing the downtown area and this campus.
We got to take our producer, Scott how do I pronounce his name?
Gustafson.
Easy for me to
this
say.
This might be your last game, but.
Easy for me to say. I was about to say Gustafson. I was about to butcher that. Gustafson. Easy for me to say. He's a veteran.
How do you feel about Big Sky baseball?
Gus comes out a lot easier.
You like going to Montana for baseball?
I hear it's pretty out there.
Right. That was
so
awesome.
Great.
You are a beautiful human being.
Thank you, Dave. Thanks for covering me there.
A.J. Causey working to Josh Pearson. 2-1 count. That's a moment LSU won. You know, Jay Johnson talking to us today about there's going to be three or four moments in a game where you have to win those moments. Mm. And even though LSU gave up a run there, that was a moment LSU won to get out of that what could have been a huge inning for Tennessee.
Yeah, you pointed out that they didn't quite capitalize offensively, but, boy, did they minimize the damage on D.
And Pearson lifts this one high in the air, deep to left. Inslee on the run against the wall. Boy, did he cover some ground to make that catch. And that ball kept tailing away from him as the wind is blowing toward left.
That was phenomenal. And this ball is riding the wind. The wind's blowing, again, across the field right to left. And Inslee is full throttle. Tracking that baseball right into the 385 sign and a face full of wall, but he finishes it off, and, man, is Causey fired up. Again, it's been a struggle for him lately. Could have easily been a leadoff double. Instead, it goes as an out.
Hayden Travinsky now steps in, the Tiger designated hitter. He looks at a first pitch strike. With a guy like Causey who could really spin that across the plate, could you get a read on it in that at-bat, or did it take you an at-bat or two to kind of get a feel for his pitch?
The breaking ball, it would take you a couple times seeing it for sure. I think once you pick up the release point, the sinker I don't think is as big a problem. But does the slider, does it have some depth to it? Is it, you know, is it bigger? Is it shorter? How slow is it? All those things are questions you've got to kind of answer the first time through. And that's why sometimes these guys that are really different looks work better as just one time through the lineup guys, right? Because the stuff's not super overpowering. So sometimes the second time through really becomes a problem.
Travinsky's first time up, struck out. Albeit that was against Chris Stamos. Boy, smashes that one foul. Stravinsky had a nice run late last year offensively. Had a great regional where he hit 429, a couple of home runs. Also hit 538 in the SEC tournament, including a game where he went 4-for-4 against Arkansas.
No, he was hitting like Mike Piazza down the stretch.
Yes, he was.
Looks like Mike Piazza. He was hammering the ball a la Piazza. And it was a big reason they were so strong to finish last year.
Bat could not meet ball. And a swing and a miss. That is the fifth strikeout for LSU tonight. Coming up, we'll talk to Tony Vitallo. Talk to Coach about his pitching situation and his thoughts about how it's gone so far with the way he drew it up tonight, with Stamos getting the start, turning it over to A.J. Causey.
One thing we're seeing from Causey tonight that might be part of the plan for him moving forward, we're starting to see some more right-on-right changeups, right? The changeup has been so good to left-handers when he's been able to throw it, but tonight we're seeing it versus righties. What do we got here?
I think Jeff Head was talking to our home plate umpire, C.J. Burdett, about maybe Causey going to his mouth while he was on the mound, perhaps. I saw him kind of like, yeah, see, I think that's what he's talking about.
Uh-huh. Did they award a ball to it, or? He's allowed to do it as long as he's off the rubber.
Yeah, he may have done it while he was on the rubber. I mean, Jeff had clearly made that gesture to C.J. Burdett. Didn't seem to affect him on that pitch as Brady Neal took a big hack and misses 0-1. Brady, the sophomore out of Tallahassee, Florida, went to IMG Academy. And he's down 0-2. Brady drafted by the Brewers coming out of high school, but he turned that down to come play for the Tigers. Good inning for Causey and the Vols. And joining us down in that Tennessee dugout is their head coach, Tony Vitallo. And, Tony, thanks for joining us. And, obviously, you switch things up on the mound. You get Stamos out there. Now you bring in Causey. So far, so good. And I guess I shouldn't say that. What do you think of how it's gone?
Well, if we had Chris Burke playing shortstop, we would have caught that ball in left field. Right. I mean, Dean is a freshman, and he doesn't act like it. He actually did a great job of pointing the ball out. Just Dylan couldn't find it. But, you know, both guys have gone out there and competed the way we want to, and I think, you know, Stamos really picked his teammate up well, because we're looking for just a little stress relief for Causey, really.
Mm-hmm. What does it mean to have Billy Amick back in the lineup?
It means a lot. I kind of liked him when he was, you know, I called him Coach Billy when he was sitting right to the right of us, and he was kind of telling guys where to go and having fun in here in the dugout. But he's much better served for the Vols out there on the field, and it's weird how well he fits in for being a guy that it's his first year and obviously being a transfer guy. But it's just kind of been a seamless match, and it doesn't always work out that way.
Hey, Tony, one last thing for you. This lineup, obviously, is one of the best put together. But from your perspective, standing there in the dugout, I mean, how do you describe 1 through 9 that you throw out there?
Well, I think the best compliment you could pay the guys is if you flipped it upside down, you know, maybe you kind of got the same order for the most part. I don't think you want Simo. First of all, we don't want that to be a strike, but you don't want Simo hitting 9-hole. But I think that's kind of the best way to compliment it. And I think they work together, and we've had a lot of nights where, you know, 2 or 3 guys in random spots have been the best guy, and then sometimes it's your 1-2, you know, older guys that are our best punch.
Well, it certainly has been a fun team to watch. Good luck rest of the way. Thanks for joining us, Tony.
Okay, you bet. Y'all take care.
That's interesting. Flip the lineup, and you'd feel like you could have just as much success. There aren't a lot of teams that can say that.
No, and you know, that might be a little bit of an exaggeration, but I think his point is valid in that it is scary from top to bottom, similar to that 22 club. Last year's team wasn't quite as dangerous as you got towards the tail end of the batting order, but this year's club reminds you a lot of that 22 team, which just felt like you were holding your breath really when any and every player stepped up to bat because there was just so much power in the lineup.
That one is off the plate to Hunter Ensley. Through 33 games, Tennessee is ahead of their program record pace from 22 when they hit 158 home runs. This year's 90 round trippers are 11 more than the 22 squad had through those 33 games. And there's a comparison. I mean, they're even scoring more this year. They lead the country in runs per game.
Yeah, I mean, the average in slugging is like well ahead. So you look at those numbers, and you know they're not just ahead; they're well ahead.
Yeah. Of course, the 14 home runs in three games last weekend at Auburn.
Yeah, that'll jump you up there.
By the way, that was in 23 innings. They didn't even play the full 27 innings because of run rules. That one's popped up way in the sky, stays in the infield. Tommy White charges in, and foul territory will make the catch. Sunday is the final day of the NBA regular season. Hard to believe it's already coming to a close. The Bulls take on the Knicks at 1 o'clock Eastern time on ESPN. Then at 3:30, we'll have the Lakers and the Pelicans. Coverage tips with NBA Countdown at 12:30 Eastern time. Can you believe we're already coming to the end of the
getting to the end of the road.
Damn. That one's fouled back out of play. Nine-hole hitter Cal Stark. He struck out his first time up. Gage jump up to 85 pitches now. Giving up four hits, but one of those was a two-run shot off the bat of Billy Amick back in the first inning. Tennessee had a chance to really open this game up with one out, bases loaded. Could only get one across.
Boy, Jump is having a lot of success against Stark on that fastball up in the zone. Stark kind of likes the ball down in the bottom part of the strike zone. And right now, Jump is doing an excellent job of just throwing that four-seamer right above the belly button.
Swing and a miss, and the inning is over. Gage, Jump. Impressive to this point, but his club down a pair. First, we'll be there for first pitch to last pitch. I'll tell you what, you and I have been doing this a long time. This will be my 28th, 27th baseball tournament or something. I can't remember going to this tournament with more star power than we have scattered through this league. There are so many individual performers. Some teams have multiple, but
yeah.
But the amount of, I mean, guys that are putting on clinics on how to play the game is incredible this year. So now we get our third base umpire, Michael Snover, talking to A.J. Causey about him going to the mouth while he's engaged.
Calling that a ball. So, yeah, they're on him about – I guess he needs to be off of the mound, I guess is what they're on him about it.
So LSU going with pinch hitter Steven Milam, a 5'8 freshman at Las Cruces, New Mexico, grabbing a bat. Count now 3-0. Milam hitting 314. Been a regular in the lineup and taking the day off today from the starting nine. 314 on the year. No homers and 17 runs batted in. The 3-1, make it 3-2.
You know, I'm thinking about the statement you made about the star power that we'll have in Hoover, because we did have Cruz, Skeens, and Langford last year at the top. And, you know, we had Dolan. We had a fair amount of first-rounders.
Swing and a miss, first out of the inning. So it bounces back from a 3-0 count.
But it will be interesting to see if there's more this year, because there's a ton as we see Causey continuing to get some depth. That changeup just pulling the string on that arm side changeup. And that seems to be the difference maker for him in this ballgame. Plus, a guy like Causey needs a little wiggle room on the edges of the strike zone, right? So C.J. Burdette has proven that he's, you know, he'll call some pitches that are maybe what we would consider to be more old-school college baseball strikes, and that's helpful for a sinker baller like Causey.
Now another pinch hitter is Jake Brown. Will slide in to hit for Paxton Kling.
So they're going left-handed versus Causey here. They kind of had a right-handed lineup out there to start against Stamos, and now throwing some lefties out here against Causey.
Jake Brown playing in his 29th game. He has 9 starts, hitting .286 on the year with a homer. Two and one the count. Make it 2-2.
That front hip sinker, one that starts in off the plate against the left-handers and runs back, and then the changeup combo working pretty good right now for Causey.
Fouled back. 2-2. That one's fouled back. Off the plate, it'll go full 3-2. Jake, drafted by the Rangers, coming out of high school. Turned it down, came to LSU, was number one overall player in the state. But Causey with another strikeout. He has struck out 5 of the last 6.
Boy, it's been impressive with that changeup. There's a changeup just running hard. There's a changeup. Those two versus righties. How about a little front door two-seamer? Then changeup, and then he got Brown with the changeup as well. So we are seeing the best version of A.J. Causey here in this ballgame, leaning on that changeup.
So the top of the lineup now, Jared Jones, who has a flyout and a walk. Jared's average at 302 now. That one misses down. The man they call Bear. Tied that LSU record with 3 homers against McNeese State in their midweek game. And that one will find a little hole on the left side. Boy, his last 5 games, he's hitting over 400 now for LSU.
And how about since he's been plugged into that leadoff spot? I mean, what a decision by Jay Johnson. I was thinking about this week. If you flew somebody in that had never seen the game of baseball and you said, what would you think about batting my best hitter first? They'd say, well,
wouldn't you want to do that?
Right.
Why wouldn't you do that?
I'm going to put my hottest, most dangerous hitter first. Well, yeah, that seems to make a ton of sense, you know. And that's just, it's that simple.
Sharply hit. Not the second. Christian Moore. They had him played perfectly, and Tommy White is retired, and the inning is over. It's a 3-1 Tennessee lead. A cool but beautiful night here in Knoxville, Tennessee, on the banks of the Tennessee River. Tomorrow the place will be bustling. Spring football. We got game two of this series, but game one looks like this. 3-1. Of course, the big shot off the bat of Billy Amick, a two-run homer in the first. But Gage jumped, four innings pitched, three runs, five strikeouts, three walks. Has pitched out of a couple of jams. He is working on his 90th pitch of the game to the leadoff man for Tennessee, Christian Moore. And that one misses a little bit down and away. The man they call Simo lays off of that one as well. A couple of singles for Christian Moore. See his average jump up to 361 now. And now it's 3-0. Gage Jump, who transferred to LSU after 2 years at UCLA, trying to get through the fifth inning. There's a strike at 3-1. Came out as a number one ranked left-handed pitcher in the state of California and the number five overall prospect out of that state. That one's down. So Milam is out at shortstop after pinch hitting, and Jake Brown will be out in center field as he replaced Paxton Kling. Time is taken. Brady Neal walking out to the mound. Slow walk.
Well, with the renovations here at Lindsey Nelson, you can't really see the visiting bull. Oh, there it is, the bullpen cam. We got Cam Johnson, who's one of the most talented freshman left-handers in the country. And Samuel Dutton down there, the veteran right-hander. This is a tall task for anybody. Gage Jump has been steady in this ball game, but to make it through the top of this order three times, it's a tall ask.
Not to mention when you walk the first guy you see, and now Blake Burke steps in there and lifts this one down the line and left. It is curving toward the seats, and it'll get there. It's a good look at the part of the new renovations completed in the offseason. Extended the grandstands, permanent seats down there. And, of course, I love that little angle right down there in the corner. That's kind of where I think I'd like to hang out.
You'd
right
like
there.
To settle in there. And yeah. They finally, we've gotten wise enough in America with our netting down the lines all the way. So now, like right there, you don't have right, to worry right. about wearing one in the teeth.
Top three hitters in this Tennessee lineup, 4-for-6. That's all the hits for the Vols tonight. Both teams with four hits. Just did get a piece, stays alive, 0-2 on Burke, who's kept his hit streak alive. It's now at 24 games.
Remarkable turnaround from last year. You know, as loud as his hits are, to get 24 hits in or games in a row with a hit, that is just consistency I didn't see coming from him.
Tony Vitello talking to us about how he just loves the art of hitting, studies it, it's become part of his everyday routine, is video sessions as well as, you know, taking 1,000 cuts.
Yeah, gave Josh Elander a bunch of credit. Third base coach, hitting coach, recruiting coordinator for this team that has done such a great job helping to develop all the talent that they've brought in here. And, boy, they pumped out some hitters. Trey Lipscomb, the first one of the most recent group to get to the big leagues, but – of course, Drew Gilbert. Andre Lipsius made his way to the big leagues here recently. They have developed some power bats in this program over the last few years.
Here's the 2-2. Now it's full at 3-2. Depending on the outcome of this pitch, this might be the last one for jump, I would think, if he can't get Burke.
Yeah, you're probably going for the righty to pitch to Amick.
That bounces high in the air. Jones finally finds it. Everybody's safe. Did that hit the bag and pop up?
Yeah, I think that's exactly what happened. And it's crazy. I don't think Jones was – I don't think he – look how close he is to the base line. That ball's hit so hard.
Oh, my. He couldn't even react.
He couldn't even react. Look, he is a step from the base, and that ball hit the base before he could get his glove down. And then bounces into no man's land. And as you called, Dave, we will see a new arm for the Tigers.
Jay Johnson out to the mound, and Tennessee – looking to put up a crooked number here. They have nobody out and two on. And the three-hole hitter, Amick, coming up. He's already has a two-run shot tonight. But Gage jumped, though. Pitched well tonight. But he'll leave with his team down 3-1. We'll update the change when we come back. Stay with us. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Boy, I tell you what, our producer Scott Gustafson works hard, doesn't he? Goes out there, get on the boat, cold night, down the river.
I like to call him Gus.
Just go with Gus. There's Gage Jump, whose night is over. Gage, four innings, five hits, five strikeouts, but four walks. Two on via a walk and a base hit, and he turns it over to this guy, the junior out of Southside, Alabama, Samuel Dutton, 5'11", 200 pounds, now in his third year with this LSU program. So he's making his ninth appearance of the year, 12 innings and 14 strikeouts, just one walk on the year.
Yeah, and you're going to see a lot of cutters and sliders. So the fastball's up to 93, 94 miles an hour, but he likes to spin that cutter, spin that breaking ball to the glove side, away to right-handed hitters. Something tells me in a situation like this, he's going to lean on that pitch heavily against Billy Amick.
Amick with a two-run homer back in the first inning on the first pitch he saw since his return to the field since March 24th. After having to have some minor surgery back on the field, and Tony Vitale's telling us he had a kind of behind the curtain live at bats, a few live at bats this week, and he watched him. He goes, "Yeah, I think he's okay to go. Well, you know, I might run him out there." Well, I think he is more than okay to go. Ground ball out to short. He'll get one there, try to turn it over there, and Jones can't pick it, and that'll get a run home. So Milam, who just came into the game replacing Braswell, starts what should have been a double play.
Yeah, I thought Milam did a nice job. Good quick transfer on kind of an in-between hop, and then Pearson just throws it right into the ground, and not an easy chance for Jones at all. And unfortunately for LSU, the ricochet takes it into the seats. And after a couple really nice cutters, what are we reviewing?
I didn't pick up what Jeff Head was saying, but we are reviewing something. I think they're going to challenge the slide if it was a proper slide into second base by Amick.
That would have been Burke. Right? It would have been
exactly. Burke. Yeah.
Slides right into the base.
Yeah, there's nothing there.
Can't slide any more into the base than that.
Yeah.
Mr. Head's ready to. There it is.
After review, the slide to second base is legal. The runner is out. LSU's recharged one challenge.
So they should be out of challenges. They thought they had the challenge at the plate on the play at the plate.
And Tennessee challenged play to play.
No, oh, yeah, you're right.
It's not
it's
here,
right
buddy.
Here, man. Pick
right,
me up.
Right.
Pick me up, buddy.
Got you.
And I picked you up with our producer earlier tonight. Yeah, so we're even.
Yes, you did.
It's now a 4-1 Tennessee advantage. As Kavaris Tears strolls into the batter's box. Couple of walks for Kavaris. Well, he is as far back in that batter's box as you can possibly go. Where did you like to stand in the batter? Were you a back foot on the line guy?
Yeah, I put my back foot on the line. I wasn't trying to, you know, be in the catcher's lap that I was so far back there. But, yeah, my back foot was usually the outside of my back foot was on the inside of the line. He's got the opposite.
Fouls it back again. So if you're a pitcher and you see a guy that far back in the box, are you trying to drop something in front of the plate there? I mean, what would be your mindset at that point when you see a guy?
Oh, I don't think you're paying too much mind to that. I think it's more if you see a guy on the opposite side of the box. If he's way up in the front, that right. would. There's so few people that do that.
That one bounces away to throw. Neal gets past the third baseman, White, and that will get the fifth run home.
I mean, that just has to be frustrating. First of all, this is a ball that you expect an SEC catcher to block. Then you got a chance to throw him out. And you, not only do you not throw him out, you throw it down the left field line. Like, that's just – that's turning one mistake into two, and that's a play Brady Neal would love to have back. But Jay Johnson not happy with that sequence of events right there.
Underhand scoop. That'll be out number two. Hey, UFC 300. Tomorrow night in Las Vegas, highlighted by two title fights and some of the greatest fighters in UFC history. The main card begins at 10 Eastern, 7 Pacific on pay-per-view with the prelims at 8 Eastern on ESPN and ESPN Deportes. ESPN Plus coverage begins at 6 Eastern. To order the main card in English and Spanish, go to ESPNplus.com/PPV. 5-1 Tennessee out in front with two outs, and Dylan Dreiling steps in and he looks at ball one.
So Tennessee this innings has a walk, a ball that hit the base, what should have been a double play, and then just scored on a wild pitch E2.
Boy, Dutton getting really frustrated out there. He's felt like the last two, at least the first one. Should have been a strike. And then this happens. Dreiling launches one to right. Is it enough? Yes, it is. Home run. Dylan Dreiling. Number 13.
Well, there's that hanging cutter right there. This one's supposed to be on the back door. And well, he didn't have any doubts about it leaving the yard right into the short porch down the right field line. Catches that cutter just out in front. And Tennessee's hung a three spot in this inning. That's the first ball they've hit that left the infield.
And now it's 6-1. Dean Curley. Early has flown out. And then hit a foul pop down the right field line. It turned out to be a double play as the runner at third tagged up. They nailed him at the plate to end the inning. So an 0 for 2 night so far for Curley. Tennessee up to 91 home runs now. Chasing Georgia, who has the NCAA lead. Georgia had 3 last night, pushed them to 92. I don't know if they have one. If you looked at, see if they had, check that out for me. See if they've got a home run tonight. This one's hit deep to left, but not deep enough.
And now,
and the center fielder, Brown, comes over to make the catch. That'll do it, but a big inning for Tennessee. They lead it by 5 now. It has been certainly a tough go of things after you win a national championship, especially if you come out of the Southeastern Conference. You see what Mississippi State, their first ever one. They come back and they start 4-8 in league play. 2022 Ole Miss, they go 2-10 the following year to start SEC play. And LSU, with their 7th national championship last year, they have yet to win a series in the SEC, and they're 3-9, entering weekend number 5 in the conference.
This league will beat you up.
It will, man. You said it earlier. The line, the margin for error is so small in this league. And it's so easy to get on the bad side of that.
Yeah, it totally is. And you're also, you know, you lost some generational players.
Oh.
I mean, you lost some guys that they're probably going to build statues of. And not to mention guys like Dugas and Beloso. I mean, guys that were heart and soul clutch performers. You just don't replace that right away. I mean, obviously the portal exists, and you can add some pieces, but Skeens and Cruz, and, of course, the way Ty Floyd pitched for them down the stretch, like, that's just – I mean, Tommy White's really, you know, and Travinsky was out there quite a bit, but really, other than those two, I mean, it's a brand-new position player group.
Cruz hit .426 last year. Tommy White hit .374. Beloso is .324. You're talking about 18, 24, 16 home runs respectively for those top three guys. You can't overlook Trey Morgan.
Trey Morgan, yeah.
I mean, you just knew what you were getting every time you penciled him in the lineup.
And the best defensive first baseman in the country.
Who ended up playing a lot of outfield last year.
Another heart and soul guy.
Braden Joubert. Dugas.
Dangerous. Yeah.
Boy, that was a great pitch from A.J. Causey. Well, Skeens didn't make the big league show yet.
Yeah.
But he is lighting up AAA baseball right now. Dylan Cruz, the number 2 overall pick.
In Double-A to start.
And I don't think it'll be long before. I don't know. It's hard to say where he'll end up by the time this season's over.
Yeah, I think with Cruz, you know, with a hitter, first full year in pro ball, you're going to – obviously, Lankford, different story just with how quickly the Rangers decide to move on him. Most guys, they're gonna let him probably spend at least a few months in Double-A, and if he's tearing it up, he'll get his shot maybe by the end of the summer.
Mac Bingham now with one down. Ground ball back up the middle. That'll be a base hit for Bingham. 5th hit of the night for LSU.
Well, the thing from Causey, and obviously the first hitter hit that ball deep into left center field that Inslee made such a great catch on. But besides that, Causey's kept the ball on the ground, right? He's had a bunch of punch outs, and then the balls that have been in play have been mostly on the ground, which is exactly his MO when he's working at the best version of his stuff.
Josh Pearson now. Pearson hitting fifth in the LSU lineup tonight. 0 for 2 with a couple of flyouts. Chopper to first, fielded there by Burke. Throws to second, throws a laser, and got him. What a throw. What a play by Blake Burke.
Wow. I didn't know he had that kind of arm, Dave Neal. This ball is ripped. Looking like Todd Helton over first base. Tackled and let it fly, young man. This is as good as it gets from the first base position to get your team off the field.
Heading to the bottom of the sixth inning, Tennessee up 6-1, the fourth-ranked team in the country. LSU out of the rankings for the first time in a year. It has been a fine line that LSU's been walking. Bargo, Brady Neal hops up from behind the plate to make a nice defensive play for LSU to get the first out of the inning. But, you know, talking to Jay Johnson today, you just, you know, you go through these games. We ask him to kind of, you know, give us your thoughts from your perspective on that this season. And he runs through these games, and it's like one pitch here, one at-bat was the difference. And it's just as we've said, the margin is just so small. And those things last year, they were so good they could overcome some of those things. But this is a different team.
Oh, yeah, and you're just clinging to those plays. They stand out because of – you feel like you're right in the ball. You know, two of the last 3 weeks, they win game one, and they got a chance to win game two. Last week, specifically at Vanderbilt, they took the lead multiple times down the stretch of that game. And just the problem has been game three. They have not been able to, you know, they've been run-ruled a few times. They have really struggled in game three of series so far this year. But, I mean, they're a couple plays away. They could, you know, they played 12 games. They could easily be 5-7 or 6-6.
Hunter Inslee, he looks at a called third strike. Hey, Berkey, it's week three of the UFL.
Okay.
I know you've been keeping up with things. Tomorrow, the Defenders versus the Renegades at 1 Eastern on ESPN. And at 7 on Fox, the Showboats take on the Stallions. Sunday, the Roughnecks and the Panthers kick off at noon Eastern on ABC with the Battle Hawks and the Brahmas at 3 on ABC.
I think I heard Jarrett Garantano was starting for the Roughnecks.
How about you locked in? Of course, following the volunteer quarterback in his post-Tennessee career.
Spring football. Still hard to wrap your brain around that. Of course, we got SEC spring football here on campus tomorrow.
I know. You've talked about it. I know. Fully aware of that.
Got to go see Nico Iamaliava.
You know, I don't know. I did, what, 4 Tennessee football games last year, maybe something like that. And he got in a couple of them, and a couple were the non-conference games.
Yeah.
Nico would be his time. But he just didn't play as much as I was hoping he'd play. Like, he played, came in and, you know, play some series in third quarter, and then they go to the next guy. And I'm like, no, man.
There's some people in the fan base that agree with you.
I'm like, no. But now we'll get to see a lot of Nico.
There's that cutter. This is a better matchup for Cal Stark, right? Jump kept throwing that fastball up above the belt. Dutton, while he'll throw the four-seamer, he really wants to get you out with breaking balls. Oh, here's that fastball up again. Stark is just not getting the barrel there.
Called strike three. Inning is over. Nice work from Samuel Dutton, but LSU down five. Well, things got started in the first inning for Tennessee when Billy Amick, first pitch he sees in a couple of weeks, hits it into the party deck. Then they, LSU with a nice defensive play out and right as Ashton Larson makes the catch, and then the play at the plate to tag up, to tag Burke would end the inning. No damage there, but then there would be yet another home run as Dylan Dreiling, last one to right for the second homer of the night for the Tennessee Vols. Just another multi-homer game for Tennessee. How about 12 times this year? They've had four home runs in a game. 12 times. Four blasts.
No, I mean, the numbers are a little numbing. Like, for some reason, four doesn't even sound that much for what they do sometimes.
Travinsky gets one to drop. His first hit, now one for three tonight for Hayden Travinsky.
Well, and I you know, we saw it was a little shaky early. But I think, you know, the offense you expect with this team. I think the big development tonight is Stamos looked very steady and trustworthy opening the game. And then Causey's had it, the best stuff he's had in a month. So, you know, I think if you're Frank Anderson and Tony Vitello, that's really what has you most excited through the first two-thirds of this ball game.
That's in there for a strike to Brady Neal. Coach Vitello was telling us today about how he needs Causey because there's no A.J. Russell there, so you've lost a good piece of your puzzle. He needs a Causey to go 70 to 100 pitches on a weekend. He needs Beam to do 70 to 100 pitches just the way this staff is set up. So whether you get 70 to 100 coming out of the pen or 70 to 100 to start, that ball's lifted high in the air. Tears toward the line, he'll make the catch, and that'll be the first out. But I guess the point is however he can get Causey to give him those kind of numbers, he'll do it.
Yeah, I mean, they're a little lighter on the mound from a depth standpoint than they've been in years past. And so, you know, heck, there's last couple years, if you have a run like A.J. Causey's had over the last couple weeks, you'd be way back in the pecking order, right? But he's going to keep getting the baseball. Because number one, he's proven it through the first 6 weeks of the season. But number two, they don't have a ton of guys that have shown the flashes that he's shown. So he's going to get another opportunity, and boy, is he taking advantage of it.
Milam's second at bat came in to pinch hit for Braswell. Stayed in to play shortstop, struck out his first time up, and he's behind 0-1 here. Six Ks and one walk for Causey tonight. Milam out of Las Cruces, New Mexico. Was their state's Gatorade High School Player of the Year after he hit 627. The guy just raked in high school, hit 513 over his four-year high school career.
New Mexico is probably the best place to hit on earth. And that, no disrespect to my man, Mr. Milo.
I mean, you just chopped him at the knees right there.
I'm just telling you, bro. Ball does not come down in New Mexico. You talk about thin air.
Well, he grew up watching Alex Bregman play for LSU and kind of started wearing that hat as a youngster because of Alex, who had a huge influence. Says he's a real role model for him, but he'll go back to the dugout.
That's one more K for Keith.
That's seven strikeouts now for Causey.
Boy, and it's this changeup over and over and over again. This changeup just continues to baffle these LSU left-handers. Lefties have been having tremendous success. Came in with huge numbers the last couple weeks against Causey, but not tonight. And the big reason is that changeup.
That's 10 total strikeouts by Tennessee pitching tonight. Jake Brown now, who also came on as a pinch hitter back in the fifth inning for Paxton Kling, and he struck out his first appearance against Causey.
And it's quickly 0-2.
Well, he's in some sort of rhythm right now. Works with great pace and just filling the strike zone up.
Ground ball to the right side, knocked down by Burke. He'll step on the bag, and the inning is over. We'll head to the bottom of the seventh inning. Tennessee holding on to the 6-1 advantage. Boy, gorgeous downtown Knoxville, Tennessee on this Friday night. We were strolling through downtown earlier today, Berkey, and
yeah.
We stumbled across a sign on this, what is now a hotel, that said the SEC was created in this hotel, which is now, I think, a Hyatt Place.
But yeah, on Gay Street.
Right, on Gay
it
Street.
Is. Yeah.
On December 12th, 1932. How about that?
A little Knoxville history for
yeah,
you.
Man. And here we are, 2024, calling an SEC baseball game. Aiden Moffitt takes over, his 13th appearance on the bump. He has thrown 12 innings, 8 walks, 19 hits. Moffitt, the sophomore out of Mount Olive, Mississippi. 6'3", 221. And if there has to be an area that has maybe let this team down the most, it's just trying to find some quality arms out of that bullpen. It's just the consistency. You don't know what you're getting from night in, night out. There are some lively arms, some guys with impressive numbers when you look at the stats. Spin rates, velocity, all that stuff.
Yeah.
It looks good, but they just haven't been able to get people out.
No, and Jay said it's time for him to start giving some new guys chances on the weekend, right? So Aiden Moffitt gets his chance here on a Friday night in the SEC to prove that he can be one of the guys Jay Johnson and Nate Yeske can trust.
Pitched in just one game last year for LSU. Came out of Mississippi as their number one ranked right-handed pitcher in the class of 2022. Did he go? No swing, says Jeff Head.
See, the fastball is sitting there at 96. He averages just a click below that. So, you know, you can see why they want to run him out there. Slider's been really good this year, too. 85, 86, high whiff rate.
3-1. Down in the zone. Don't forget, we'll be back here tomorrow. We'll be here all weekend, as a matter of fact. We'll just kind of set up shop this weekend in Knoxville. We'll have game two of this three-game series at 5:30 Eastern tomorrow afternoon right here on the SEC Network. Game three will be at 3 o'clock Eastern on the SEC Network as well. Hopefully it'll be a little warmer tomorrow.
I think the forecast is calling for that.
The wind has gotten out of here for the most part. Boy, it was just howling earlier today. Here's Blake Burke.
So this is where you're really going to start to find out whether this youngster can pitch in the Southeastern Conference. What's he do against a left-handed hitter behind in the count? There you go. Trust his stuff. Hammer a fastball to the outside corner at 96. Doesn't get much better than that. Oh, changeup. 88 mile an hour change piece. That was nasty.
With some serious drop in that.
Blake Burke's like, oh, okay.
Okay.
We didn't have a lot on the report with this guy.
1-2 on Burke. Runner goes, swing and a miss. Here's the throw down, and it's plenty of time. It is a strike him out, throw him out. That looked pretty clean and crisp from LSU.
How about that on both ends?
Now batting the third baseman.
I never liked stealing on 0-2 just because it was such a, I guess it was 1-2, such a fastball, like off the plate kind of count, but that's a, just a fastball right past Blake Burke, and Brady Neal puts it on the dot. He'll strike him out, throw him out, double play.
Now Billy Amick.
Christian Moore thought they were going to go back to that changeup right there.
And they did.
And they didn't.
And they didn't. That's he's back at the dugout talking to
yeah.
Blake well, Burke about that sequence.
I didn't guess right there.
Neither one of them did.
No. Okay, Aiden Moffitt. Do it, kid.
That was 97. Facing a guy that was part of Clemson's ACC championship team last year. Hit 413 with 13 homers.
But somehow Clemson is just rolling without him, which is pretty hard to believe considering how good a hitter Billy Amick is.
There's another strike, 2-2. Moffitt on the mound in high school, went to Taylorsville High School in Mississippi, was an offensive lineman and a defensive end on the football team.
Okay. You know he's got a little grit to him.
Now it's full 3-2.
Great take right there. Billy Amick just does a really good job with pitch recognition. Every once in a while, he can be a little tardy on the fastball, but, man, he seems to see the breaking ball very well. Look at that. I mean, he's throwing 97, right? And that's a breaking ball that's a very competitive two-strike breaking ball. Billy Amick saw that right out of his hand.
Tavares Tears now will step in after the walk. Nate Yeske out to the mound to talk to the right-hander. Again, it's like we were just talking about. There's a lot of guys that look like Moffitt, like the stuff is, but they just haven't been able to get people out, and you just need a couple of those guys to step up.
Emerge,
yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, Nate Yeske has a long track record of developing pitchers, and so, you know, even though it feels like it's getting late, there's still a good chunk of this conference schedule left to play, and it's guys like Moffitt that they're going to need to emerge if they're going to be able to finish as strong as what they hope they can do so that they can get right back in that NCAA tournament conversation.
String on that one to Tears. It's 0-1. You know, you start thinking about NCAA tournament stuff and what it takes to get in, and a magic number seems to be 15. And you might be able to get in with one or two less if things work out, the numbers play out the right way. But regardless, LSU's sitting here at 3-9. They got to turn that flips. That switch has got to flip now.
Yes, it does. And you know, it starts with just one game at a time mentality. But I think there's a piece of playing in this league where you kind of start to get numb to the team in the other dugout, and you're just so used to playing, especially the way LSU's schedule is lined out, you're just so used to playing top 10 teams that it becomes less about who you're playing against and more about your ability to just play quality baseball.
Swing and a miss, and the inning is over. So some good stuff from Moffitt. A couple of strikeouts. Tennessee will leave a couple. 6-1, Vols.
Well, we're talking about LSU and thinking way out in front of postseason baseball, and kind of the magic number, the comfortable number, is 15 conference wins. And again, there are some teams that got obviously gotten in with 14 wins, etc. But when you put up these numbers, their RPI, their strength of schedule, and versus the RPI, 15 seems to be a number that they may have to reach. However, these are what's coming up for LSU. I mean, basically, they're going to, if you say they go lose tonight and they go 3-10, they're going to have to go 12-5 the rest of the way in league games to get to the 15.
And I don't think they're going to need to get to 15. I think the strength of the schedule in this league and along with their early season non-conference, I think maybe even 13 gets them in.
Yeah.
15 for sure.
Sure, right. And I think 14 becomes kind of maybe they are. 13, I think, might be a reach just because of some of those numbers we just showed. Now, obviously, there are plenty of opportunities for those numbers to increase as the season goes on playing in this league.
And there's also, you know, you got the field, right? It's not in a vacuum. Their record's not in a – but 15, you're right. 15's like you know you're in. You don't have to worry about any of it. But you can get overwhelmed. You start looking at the top of that mountain too much. It's really just about collecting the next win that they're worried about.
Did he go? Jeff Head, they check, and no swing. Garrett Jones will get to look at another pitch.
Yeah, I think the bear held the barrel back right there.
1-for-2 for Jared Jones.
Causey just keeps painting that slider on the outside edge, and Jones is just doing a fantastic job of not biting.
Didn't go. Jones hangs in there, draws a leadoff walk here in the eighth.
How about the Missouri Tigers coming off a sweep of Florida last week? They lose a tough one last night to Georgia, but they came back. They scored 4 in the seventh to tie it up and then 1 in the tenth and beat Georgia tonight.
6-5 final score.
Missouri. It, you know, after the first few weeks, you weren't sure how many games Missouri was going to win in the league, and now they've won 4 of the last 5.
How about what we're talking about teams in this league that maybe surprised you, and it shouldn't be a surprise anymore, but obviously the way they started, Kentucky has just
it's incredible
dominated.
Yeah, and their margin of victory is insane. They're winning again tonight 6-1. They came into the week – last night they won a one-run game, but they came into the week 114-43 for the season against conference play.
Oh, and 2 on Tommy White. Just another two-hit night for Tommy Tanks. Pops him up right side. Christian Moore able to make the catch. Out number one, and that'll take us to the three-hole hitter, Ashton Larson. Larson looking for his first hit. He's lined out back in the first inning, walked in the third, and struck out looking in the sixth against A.J. Causey.
Mississippi State up 8-0 on Ole Miss tonight. Ole Miss, another team that just scuffling right now.
You got that Georgia box score up. What did Condon do tonight?
Two more hits. No homers. It's a disappointment.
Yeah, I know. It's like, oh, man. Yeah, 25 of them last year.
Yeah, just a lousy two-hit night. Two for four, two walks, and a ribby.
And his average went down. I mean, that's just – well, actually, it went up. I think it was at 480. Okay. He was 482.
480, yeah, 480-ish. Something.
Yeah, coming into it. So it'll go up a tick. Two, one. There is a strike. It's now 3-2.
Because he's had that front door sinker going all night tonight to the left-handers.
Slap base hit. Larson sends one down the line. Jones will wind up at third. Larson will wind up at second. And that is a one-out double for the freshman, his second of the year.
That's how you bounce back from thinking – you thought you walked, then you get a tough strike go against you, and then you catch a sinker right on the backside of the hitting zone. I mean, that is as deep as you can hit a ball and still keep it fair. A really polished swing right there from Ashton Larson. The Bear likes it. LSU trying to make some noise here in the top of the eighth.
And Larson just making his ninth start of the year. Hit a couple of balls really hard. This opening at bat just laced one to the second baseman. Turned out to be a double play. As Tommy White got doubled up at second base and then smokes that one down the line as Frank Anderson. Quick chat. Kirby Connell getting loose out there. He is a real-life pitching machine. He just goes, I mean, he doesn't even, he could throw you 10, he could throw you 80 pitches.
Yeah, oh yeah, he's a jack of all trades. He can do whatever they need him to do out of that bullpen. And low heartbeat more than anything. He is not rattled by the moment.
Here's Mac Bingham. Mac, the left fielder. 1-for-3 tonight. Fly out, strike out, and a single. Pitch count. Getting up there a bit now. 91 for Causey.
Good take. And this is obviously LSU running out of outs, but this is one of those times here where if you're Bingham, you got to at least get one across, make this thing a little tighter from Tennessee's perspective, but you'd love to get a base hit right back up the middle here. But that 3-1 slider. That's pitching with the guy on deck. You got Connell all ready to come in the game. You got the left-hander Pearson on deck. Not afraid to throw off speed here, even though the count's full.
Yeah, Boy, Frank Anderson pops out of the dugout. So does Tony Vitale, saying that he didn't make any effort to get out of the way of that one.
Well, he turns. Yeah, I mean, he's turning in, right? So the hitter's allowed to turn away from the ball. The body's not going towards the baseball. Right. It's going away. But it definitely was a movement.
Previous play is under review.
Yeah, I don't blame him, because if they win it, it's strike three, right? Because those are your only two options there.
I don't think this will be take very long. Although, you know what, he is turning away. But the initial
at the
look,
end, he's definitely turning away. Yeah. As Paul Gilliatt would say, did the ball hit the batter, or did the batter hit the ball? I think the ball hit the batter there.
I'm with you.
After review, ruling on the field is confirmed. Hit by pitch, batter runners awarded first base.
There you go. Dude, you're bleeding over there. You okay?
Oh, I'm good, man.
What happened there? Cut your hand on something?
No, don't.
You're all right.
I'm good. I played with worse.
That's why you wear oven mitts, man, so you don't get your hands hurt.
I should be wearing oven mitts. Maybe I could borrow one. There's definitely plenty to spare. These two dugouts.
Well, Tennessee going to the oven. They're going to pull out this guy. Kirby Connell, take it over. We'll update it when we come back.
Hey, Causey came into this ball game scuffling in his last couple outings, but boy, did he find his rhythm tonight. The changeup was nasty. The sinker, especially that front door sinker to lefties, was on point all night long, but he just kept leaning into that changeup and getting these LSU hitters out in front. Tremendous outing to get back on track from A.J. Causey, showing the ability to bounce back, make adjustments, and that'll earn you a bunch of hugs in the dugout, because that's a heavy workload he put in tonight coming in out of the bullpen.
Well, to say that he needed that would be an understatement. Rattled the last couple of nights. He's been out there on the mound, but now he'll try to turn this thing over to Kirby Connell, the senior out of Johnson City, Tennessee. 12th appearance. 17 strikeouts and 17 innings, giving up 14 hits.
Not dominant stuff, but what you're going to see from Kirby is the ability to spin the breaking ball and work the fastball to both sides of the count. Like every lefty that's not overpowering, he does a really nice job of pitching into righties to try to speed them up to throw them that breaking ball.
Then he starts Ethan Fry, who's pinch hitting, off with a strike. 217 hitter on the year. Opponents hitting 219 against Kirby. Giving up just one home run on the year. Throw back to first. Boy, Burke had to scoot over there and make a nice defensive play. As the bases are loaded.
That one could have got real interesting if that got past Burke.
One and two the count. Swing and a miss, and Fry goes down for out number two.
Just nasty. You talk about pulling the string on the outside corner, backdoor breaking ball. And, you know, Fry's still very young in his career. You just don't see a ton of backdoor breaking balls from left-handers. Mostly back foot breaking balls that are coming in and towards your barrel. That one just starts in what felt like, I'm sure, the first base dugout, cuts back across the outside corner. Huge out right there from the veteran left-hander, Connell.
Boy, Jeff Head hearing it from that Tennessee dugout right now.
Ooh, that one was awfully close.
Travinsky fouls that one into the dugout. That is a foul ball. We'll do it again. One and two. Well, these two guys, Kirby Connell and Hayden Travinsky, they have been around the SEC a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Crowd rising to their feet here.
I always find it amazing, though, as talented as Tennessee has been in the Tony Vitello era, and as many arms as they have, Kirby Connell has found a way year after year where the fastball gets to 87 miles an hour to be in these kind of big moments.
By the way, it's been bumped up to 87 this year.
Yeah, 88 right there. He grabbed a gear four-seamer just under the hands. That's a speed-up pitch. Let's see where he goes right here.
Out into shallow left, center, and that'll be caught by Ansley, and the inning is over. So Kirby Connell comes out of that bullpen and shuts it down. Tigers will leave him loaded. We'll head to the bottom of the eighth. Tennessee up 6-1. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Dave Neal, Chris Burke, glad you could join us. Chilly night here in Knoxville.
Some handle it better than others. Right?
Yes, they do. Cam Johnson, boy, you want to talk about another talented, lively arm. Here's one of them for you right here, the 6'5 left-hander making his 10th appearance on the year. The number's not exactly staggering. Again, another one of those guys that his stuff looks good. You just got to find a way to get guys out. 6 2/3, struck out 10, giving up just 3 hits, but it's those 12 walks that just really jump at you.
Yeah, it was his first outing of the year was half of those walks. Yeah. So it's been better since. But this is, I mean, it's a premium talent. He was in the conversation to go in the first round in last year's Major League Baseball draft and ended up not being picked high enough to forego the opportunity to come to LSU. And it's a big-time arm. You see fastball, he can get up there 96, 97 miles an hour. Got a chance to be a first rounder here in a few years, but right now they're trying to get him to a place where he can really compete consistently on the weekends in the Southeastern Conference.
Out of Upper Marlboro, Maryland, but went to IMG Academy. He'll face Dylan Dreiling to start things off. I mean, he was ranked by Perfect Game as a number 2 left-handed pitcher in the country.
Yep. You know, he was very highly projected in last year's draft, and I think the command issues are part of the reason he's here. Average fastball velo coming in at 94 miles an hour, and how about the whiff rate on that slider that you just saw at 60%? This is not a real fun at bat for left-handers.
No. Dreiling, Curley, and Bargo for Tennessee. And Jones will step on the bag and the strikeout to start things off for Mr. Johnson.
Now batting the shortstop, number 23, Dean Curley.
That was
pretty
gnarly stuff right there.
Kind of how you draw it up right there. And obviously a couple more outs left to get in this inning. But you know,
I can see why Jay Johnson was talking about starting to go to maybe some new arms and on the weekends, because Moffitt's stuff looked electric, and certainly Cam Johnson coming out of the bullpen looking sharp to start.
93 in there for a strike to Dean Curley. Curley 0 for 3. It's 3-1.
These are the kind of developmental at-bats that you got to get him out there for, right? He starts out 0-1 and then now 3-1. There you go.
Curley, the freshman out of California. Drop in for a base hit. His first base knock of the game. Sunday Night Baseball features the series finale between the Padres and the Dodgers. 7 o'clock Eastern, 4 Pacific on ESPN. ESPN Deportes and ESPN Radio. Coverage begins at 6 Eastern with Baseball Tonight. Sunday Night Countdown. Anytime you can see Shohei Ohtani, it's worth dialing it up. A pinch runner coming on for Tennessee. Ariel Antigua. He's been banged up this year a little bit. Kind of had him expected to be their shortstop. And now Robin Villeneuve will grab a bat and get a swing. The junior looks at a first pitch strike.
This is what we're talking about when we say Tennessee's got depth. Look at the numbers on Villeneuve, and he's not in the everyday lineup. Was earlier in the year, but you're talking about a hitter with an OPS over 1,000. Tony doing a heck of a job trying to keep everybody happy with such a deep, talented roster.
One gets to the backstop. Antigua will get down to second base. One and two the count to Villeneuve. .94 fastball past Villeneuve, and that'll be out number two. And the second strikeout for Cam Johnson.
The fastball got some jump to it now.
Here's Hunter Ensley. I like how Nate Yeske got out there. He got out there in a hurry. I like that.
Like your boy Skyler Meade used to run out of the South Carolina dugout. That was even pre-clock. Yeah.
Skyler down, head coach at Troy. He was a pitching coach at South Carolina, doing a nice job with the Troy Trojans. Yeah, Skyler we used to commend him for his effort out to the mound. That's what I just did with Nate. I mean, anybody's going to give me that kind of effort, I'm going to call it out.
That's right. I like it. Of course, that was back in our four-hour game days where the pitching coach was allowed to take a three-minute walk from the dugout to the mound.
Yeah, now the moment the coach leaves the dugout, 30-second clock
30
starts.
Seconds. So you better jog it or keep it real brief once you get there.
76 miles an hour.
What a curveball right there. Not the slider. That one was the bigger bender. Took a little something off, too. Now, if he can land that to go with that 94-mile-an-hour heater. That looked like a changeup, something that he turned over there at 89.
Ensley 0 for 3. Good. Ensley hitting 8th in this lineup. Came in at 286. His average has dropped 10 points tonight. There's a strike. 2-2.
And, you know, Tony V said he feels like this lineup, the strength of this lineup is that he could flip it. It wouldn't look all that much different. Last year, Hunter Ensley hit 2nd on their College World Series team. Just to give you an idea of the added depth with this club.
Did he just throw another one of those big breaking balls?
Yeah. I mean, you know, the synergy shows that the average breaking ball he throws is right at 80 miles an hour. We've seen 76, 77. Another one at 77, which I like. I mean, I think it's – if you can command it, I think it's fantastic to be able to have that kind of difference between the fastball and the breaking ball. Because even if the break isn't super sharp, you get people out in front just on the velocity change.
Out to right. Larson backpedals, makes the catch, and we'll head to the ninth inning. Tennessee trying to get 3 more outs and wrap up game one. We'll see if there's some life in those LSU bats. A chilly night, but they've got the heater out there. I like that. Need one of those up here in the booth. And then, of course, those guys make it look like it's a nice 60-degree night. But then there's some that bring their blankets. Tomorrow will be at 5:30. It's supposed to be a warmer day. It's supposed to come on, man. It's like mid-April. We should be doing some.
Yeah, it's going to be nicer tomorrow. I didn't do it. It's not my fault.
I know. Antigua stays in as he pinch ran for Curley. We'll stay in and play some shortstop here in the ninth inning. Pinch hitter is Alex Malazzo, a graduate student out of Zachary, Louisiana. Steps in against Kirby Connell. He's quickly behind 0-2. Malazzo, a 324 hitter on the year. Goes down swinging, and that's out number one.
Boy, Kirby's got his A-plus stuff tonight. I mean, that is a nasty changeup, back-to-back changeups, and he just turns over, running down and away from the barrel of Alex Malazzo. You can just trust him. You know he's going to come in ready to compete with his best stuff. He's just proven it year after year. Boy, those are some nifty Jordan cleats he's wearing out there. Let's just say we didn't have those in the late 90s, Dave.
And he's got the pitcher toe on there too, you know, keep those things clean, fresh. You don't want to, put a hole in that thing.
Of course, a little unnecessary on turf, but no, I guess they got a dirt mound out there. Okay, yeah, we got a dirt mound. Those things are super duper custom.
Remember Kramer Robertson back in the day at LSU?
Oh yeah,
he would come bust out a new pair of Jords that he had custom made. Now they're all over the place, but he did.
He was one of the first. And that was pre-NIL, pre all that.
Yeah.
I think he was just using mom's Nike account.
Well, That's lined, almost caught there by Christian Moore. That would have been a heck of a play. They had him shaded up the middle. Milam, though, hit it right on the barrel, and he'll be at first base with one down.
That ball was scorched. Now batting the center fielder. Christian Moore's playing up the middle. He can't not get there because that ball is just dotted right back up the middle.
And here is Jake Brown with his third at-bat of the night after coming in the fifth inning. 0-for-2 with a strikeout and a ground out. And that hit him. So now it'll be first and second for LSU.
Okay. Well, things just got interesting. And now you flip it to the top.
Now Tony wants to, I guess, maybe challenge this. Let's see what Jeff Head has to say.
Tennessee is using a crew chief initiated review to challenge the hit by pitch. Previous play is under review.
It's a crew chief initiation.
I tell you, based on Brown's reaction, it must have hit him because, I mean, he went right away. Couldn't hit him by much. Let's see here. Does it catch his, like, tricep? Does it hit his jersey?
Review. The call hit by pitch will stand. Batter runners awarded first.
Thank you, Jeff.
Yep. Certainly nothing on that replay that would make you overturn it.
Just can't tell.
No. Only thing you can tell is Jake Brown immediately drops his bat like he felt something nick his elbow.
So now Jared Jones in the top of this lineup, and he'll look at a first pitch strike. Jared, fly out, a walk, a single, and a walk. Reached base three times tonight for your new leadoff hitter. Actually, second game in a row now he's led off, but a new spot for him. He's behind 0-2. I wonder how many times Jared Jones has led off in his baseball career.
This would be the second. Yes.
Go down there and ask him about that tomorrow.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
And they will be loaded for Tommy White. Frank Anderson out to the mound.
Every team.
And now Nate Sneeds had to get up in that bullpen.
Yeah. Every team's mantra in an inning like this, when you go down, you know, you go in the ninth and you're down 4, 5, 6 runs, let's try to bring the tying run to the plate, right? Try to get the tying run to the plate. Well, you get the leadoff hitter on, and it doesn't feel so – or, excuse me, you get the leadoff hitter out, and you're thinking, well, this is a long shot. But, man, how about single hit by pitch, and next thing you know, you don't quite have the tying run there yet, but you're getting close.
Well, Kirby Connell came in this same situation. Bases loaded, one out, and got him out of the jam. Well, he's kind of created this mess himself now. Let's see what he does with it as Tommy White comes to the plate. Tommy tonight has doubled, singled, 2-for-4. That one's off the plate. Nowhere to put him. Tommy's average at 329. He has 11 homers on the year and 29 runs batted in. Hard to believe somebody with 11 home runs would only have 29 runs batted in.
Yeah, especially for a guy who had 105 last year.
Led the country, didn't he? I think in RBIs, yeah. Fouls that one back. Two strikes on him now. The freshman Ashton Larson on deck. That was off the plate. 2-2 now.
You got to believe he's going to go to the changeup here. It's the pitch that's been most effective and the one that, especially against the hitter as talented as White, is going to give you the best chance to produce that double play ball that you're hunting for here.
Ground ball to third. Bobbled there and booted by Amick. Everybody safe and a run scores.
Wow, that was a really awkward play. I thought Amick had the right read. You got to run through that ball. And when he gets there, he's right by the base. See, that ball is bouncing right by the base. I bet he thought it was going to hit the base. But instead it lands just past it and squeaks out of his glove. And, you know, maybe if everything went perfect there, he could have caught it and stepped on the bag and thrown across the diamond. But instead now, Dave Neal, you got the tying run to the plate.
Score that a base hit and an RBI for Tommy White. And now Ashton Larson comes to the plate. Ashton doubled his last time up. It's 0-2. There's out number two on the strikeout.
Well, it had been a minute. It had been a minute since something went right for Kirby Connell. That was a big sequence of pitches right there to erase the freshman with the breaking ball. And now one last chance here for the Fighting Tigers.
Third strike out of the game for Kirby Connell. LSU has struck out 13 times tonight against Tennessee pitching. As Mack Bingham with two outs. And that one gets past Cal Stark, and a run will score, and it's now 6-3. And now you've got the tying run at the plate.
Yes, you do.
We had it anyway, though, Burks.
No, you had the tying run at the plate last hitter. That's right.
Getting late.
Ow. Yeah, that's right.
And I'm cold. And I'm cold.
We're all in this together, Dave.
Thank you, man. Kirby Connell. Strike two on Mack Bingham. And now the crowd again on their feet. LSU making this a little squirrely for the Vols and their fans. Oh, wow. So we lose battery on our pitch comm deal. All right, it's back. To the right side, Christian Moore scoots that way, throws to first, and the game is over.
Tennessee wins the ballgame.
Tennessee will win this one 6-3 and take game number one. LSU made it interesting, but Kirby Connell and the Tennessee Volunteers will celebrate victory number one. Two more to go this weekend.
Yeah, and I think if you're a Tennessee fan, you love the fact Billy Amick came back and hit a two-run homer to get the party started, and that A.J. Causey seemingly righted the ship from what's been going wrong the last couple weekends. And if you're LSU, some promising things from your young arms, but, man, they got to get more offense going the rest of this series to keep up with this Tennessee offense.
Well, we will see you tomorrow right here at Lindsey Nelson Stadium in Knoxville. We'll have game two of the series beginning at 5:30 Eastern on the SEC Network. So for Chris Burke and our entire crew, I'm Dave Neal saying thanks for joining us. We'll say so long from Knoxville, where Tennessee wins in 6-3.